Welcome to the next new lecture in induction motor. In this lecture, we are going to discuss the power stages in an induction motor. So this is the flowchart of flowing of power from the input to the output side. So we can see that the motor input, which is given to the stator, is being taken as P1. Then we will be having some losses in the stator, copper and iron losses. So, subtracting the iron loss from the motor input, we get the rotor input. So, rotor input is given by P2, and this is the output of the motor after subtracting the losses, which is basically the iron loss. So, subtracting the rotor copper loss from the rotor input, we will be having the mechanical power developed in the rotor given by PM, and the gross torque developed is known as TG. So once we subtract the windage and the friction losses, the net output power that we get in the shaft is given by P output. So here if we see and observe like how the power flows from the input to the output with the construction. So this is your stator and this is your rotor. So the power input P1 will lead to first the few losses, that is the stator loss and the friction losses. So here we will be getting the rotor input. So this rotor input will lead to rotor copper loss, and then the output will be the gross mechanical power developed, which on subtracting the windage and the friction losses, the net output power is the shaft power. So if you remember this flow chart from the input to the output flowing the power, we can solve the problems based on the power flow of the induction motor. So stator, you have the iron loss, and iron loss comprise of the eddy current and the hysteresis loss. These basically depends on the supply frequency and the flux density in the iron core, which are practically constant. So we know that the frequency will be constant and flux will be constant. So correspondingly flux density will be constant. Hence the iron loss will be constant, which is the sum of eddy current loss and the hysteresis loss. The rotor iron loss is negligible. So whenever we are talking about the iron loss, we are talking in terms of the stator only. Whereas the iron loss that is basically taking place in the rotor is negligible, because the frequency of the rotor current under normal condition is very small. We know that relationship that the rotor frequency is slip times the supply frequency. So this rotor frequency is very less than the supply frequency, and the iron loss basically depends upon the frequency. So the rotor frequency is less, so obviously the iron loss in the rotor iron is loss, and that can be neglected. Rotor copper loss is basically 3 times the I2 square into R2, where R2 is the rotor resistance and I2 is the rotor current. 3 because we are dealing with the 3 conductors for a 3-phase system, so 3 I2 square R2. So the torque that is developed, gross torque by the motor, can be defined in terms of the rotor input or rotor output. So if we go from the rotor input, then we can say that the rotor input P2 by omega s. So omega s is basically the synchronous speed. So synchronous speed in you have the radian per second. So that is the gross torque. So it is equal to P2 by 2 pi ns. Whereas if you go from the rotor output, then instead of omega s, that is the synchronous speed, we go up with the actual speed of the rotor. So that you give Pm by omega, and omega can be written as 2 pi n. So this is the rotor speed nr. Now shaft torque, that is the main output torque on the shaft, is basically the output power divided by omega, that is the speed with which the rotor is rotating, which is given by 2 pi n. Now n and ns that we are putting in the equation are basically in revolution per second. However, if you want to take it in revolution per minute, you have to divide ns with 60. So we get the gross torque equation 2 pi ns p2 by 2 pi ns by 60, we have to divide whether we are going from the input side or output side, then we want to divide with n by 60 here and ns by 60 here. So this gives a relationship 9.55 times p2 by ns or 9.55 pm by n. So whether we are going from the input side or output side, we can determine the value of Tg, that is the gross torque, and taking the speed in RPM. So we can take the speed in RPS or in RPM by proper substitution. Then the shaft torque, similarly, we can obtain as power output by omega. So omega also we are dividing it with 60 because we want to take in RPM. That gives to be 9.55 P output by the speed of the motor in RPM. So the relationship that holds good in induction motor is the stator input P1 is equal to stator output plus the stator losses. Rotor input P2 is equal to the stator output. So whatever the output of the stator will be there, that is the value of P2, that will be the rotor input. So this is your stator, this is your rotor, and this is your P2. So stator output is equal to rotor input. And rotor gross output PM, so whatever the output is coming from the rotor, this is the gross output, not the net output, because the net output is basically in the shaft. So gross output PM is equal to rotor input, so this input P2 minus the rotor copper loss. So here you have the rotor copper loss. So rotor input minus rotor copper loss will give you the gross output power, that is PM. So if n, that is the speed in RPS, be the actual speed of the rotor, and if Tg is in Newton meter, then the rotor gross output. So the output of the rotor, this is your rotor, and the output is given by Pm, whereas the input is taken as P2. And here you have the rotor copper loss PCU. So the gross torque that is developed, so torque power is equal to torque into omega, so Pm can be written as Tg because this is gross into the speed of the rotor given by 2 pi n. Now here we have taken the n in RPS, so we have not divided with 60, so we can get the value of Tg, that is the gross torque, is equal to Pm by 2 pi n. So this is the gross torque Pm by 2 pi n, where the speed is taken in RPS, that is the revolution per second. If there is no copper losses in the rotor, then rotor output will equal rotor input and run at synchronous speed. So here this is your rotor, and rotor copper loss is zero. It means that whatever the input we are taking on the rotor, same output we are getting on the output of the rotor, because the rotor copper loss here PCU is zero. Then the gross torque is equal to P2 by 2 pi ns, and this is the speed ns we have taken because there is no copper loss, so the speed remains the same. Now what is the relationship? So Pm, that is the rotor output, is equal to Tg into omega, omega being the speed of the rotor, which can be written as 2 pi n. Then the rotor input P2 can be written as Tg into omega s. So here, when we are dealing with the input side, we are dealing with the synchronous speed. When we are dealing with the output side, we are dealing with the speed, actual speed of the rotor. So this is equal to 2 pi ns. Now rotor copper loss is basically what is the input of the rotor minus the output of the rotor. So that is given by Tg into 2 pi ns minus n. Now rotor copper loss by rotor input. So if I want to divide the rotor copper loss with the rotor input, we get ns by ns minus n by ns, so that we get as equal to the slip, because this is your rotor copper loss, you want to divide it with the rotor input, this quantity. So Tg and 2 pi will cancel out each other, and we get ns minus n by ns, which is basically the slip of the rotor. So other relationship, rotor gross output Pm is equal to the input of the rotor minus the rotor copper loss. Then the Pm we can write as P2 minus slip time the rotor input, because the rotor copper loss we can write as slip time, the rotor input that we have seen in the previous equation. Then PM, that is the output of the rotor, is equal to 1 minus slip time, the rotor input. So if we again take a ratio of the gross output PM by the rotor input, we get a ratio of 1 minus slip, because the rotor input will cancel out each other, which is equal to N by NS, because once substituting the value of slip, we get the ratio 1 minus S equal to N by NS. So rotor efficiency, so the efficiency of the rotor is basically what is the output power by input power. So that we got in terms of the speed. So this is your output speed and this is your input speed. Then if we try to find the relationship between rotor copper loss by rotor gross output, we get S by 1 minus S. So we are getting so many ratios. So if we conclude all the ratios, then we can find an important relationship between the rotor input, rotor output and rotor copper loss is basically 1 is to 1 minus slip is to S. So this is whatever you have the rotor, and in the rotor you have the input as P2, the rotor output as PM, this is the gross output, and there is the rotor copper loss. So if I take the ratio of P2, that is the rotor input, is to PM, that is the rotor output, is to the rotor copper loss, we are getting this ratio 1 is to 1 minus slip is to slip. So this ratio proportion is very important, because if we know that two quantities, the other two quantities can be easily determined. So what is the induction motor torque equation? So we know the relationship between power, torque and omega. So power is equal to torque into omega. So this relationship we can use, torque is equal to power by omega. So the gross torque, that is the torque from the output of the rotor, is equal to P2 divided by 2 pi NS. So NS is in RPS, so we have not divided it with 60. So this equation, when NS is taken in RPM, so we can see that 60 will appear in the equation, because here we have NS by 60. So this 60 has got in the numerator. So that gives you 9.55 the rotor input in divided by NS. Now the rotor input P2 can be given as the stator output. So this is equal to 3 times I2 square into R2 divided by slip, whereas the value of I2 can be given at what is the voltage divided by the impedance. So impedance is R2 square plus slip time X2 square. This is your impedance, and the voltage is S into E2, that is on the rotor side. So this is under the running condition, and we have a square term here, so that square term is appearing here. So the rotor input P2, finally we are getting an equation as 3 into slip E2 square into R2 divided by the Z square, that is the total impedance square. So the gross torque is basically P2 by 2 pi NS, whereas in terms of E2 or E1, E1 basically the stator input and E2 is the rotor input. So we can find this equation in terms of E1 or E2. So this constant 3 by 2 pi NS will remain same for both the equation, whether we are going for E2 or E1. And in this equation, the denominator Z square will also remain the same. Whereas in the numerator, you have a relationship E2 square. So E2 square can be also written as K square into E1 square, where K is basically the transformation ratio rotor to stator turns. So we know that the K, that is the transformation ratio, is equal to rotor by stator turns. So this, when substituting, we can relate the value of induced EMF E2 from E1. E1 is the stator input. So we have a constant term. We can see this is the constant of the machine, 3k square by 2 pi ns, which we can substitute in the gross torque equation. So here we have that constant k, which is the constant of a given machine, s into e1 square into r2 divided by the impedance square in terms of e1. So The next topic that we are going to take is what is synchronous watt. So synchronous watt, we can see that although it is in watt, it is the value of the torque. So when we are dealing with some torque, we say it is a synchronous watt. So the definition is synchronous watt is that torque. So it is basically the torque, not the power, at which the synchronous speed of the machine under consideration would develop a power of 1 watt. So when the machine is running at a synchronous speed, so if the machine is running at a synchronous speed and it has to develop a power of 1 watt, what is the torque required? That is known as the synchronous watt. So synchronous watt, we can give a relationship mathematically as torque is equal to power by omega. So power is equal to P2 and omega S, because this is at synchronous speed. So 2 pi NS. So 2 pi NS we can substitute, and we can find the value with respect to P2. We can put in terms of the PG. So PG by omega S will give you the value of P2. So we can also write this synchronous watt in terms of the gross mechanical power developed by the rotor output, synchronous speed by the speed of the motor into omega S. So this relationship is known as the synchronous watt. So torque in synchronous watt is equal to the rotor input. So this is your rotor, and you have the input as P2. So torque in synchronous watt is equal to rotor input, is equal to rotor copper loss by S, because we know the relationship between P2, PM, PM being the output of the machine, and this is equal to PCU, that is the copper loss. PCU can be written as 1 is to 1 minus S is to S. So we can use this relationship to find the torque in synchronous watt, which is the rotor input, is equal to rotor copper loss divided by S, because the rotor input P2 can be relate with the rotor copper loss in terms of the slip and 1. Similarly, we can relate this with PM, so PM divided by 1 minus S. So we can define the synchronous watt torque either from the rotor input side or rotor output side or the rotor copper loss side. So we have completed the power flow of an induction motor and different losses that has taken place in the stator and the rotor. Also, we saw how to find the torque from the rotor input side or rotor output side. So we have to just be careful in substituting the value of the speed, whether we are taking the synchronous speed or whether we are taking the rotor speed, either in RPS or in RPM. So properly substituting the values of the speed and in RPS or RPM, we can get the value of the torque and the power. Thank you for now.